The following is a Hoop Ball presentation.
Welcome to another edition of Hoop Ball Sacramento Podcast. I'm your host, Christian Villere. You can find me on Twitter at my buddy Chris. For all Hoop Ball Sacramento Kings coverage on Twitter, it's at Hoop Ball Kings. And for all of your NBA news, NBA fantasy news, and Sacramento Kings coverage, period. It's hoop-ball.com. Go there, get the season pass now. If you're playing fantasy basketball, it is a must-have. It gets you access to all the premium content that HoopBall puts out. And if you're a new user to DraftKings and deposit $10 there, get to the season pass for free. You can find this show on iTunes, Stitcher, YouTube, Google Play, as well as the iHeartRadio, HoopBall Radio, and Dash Radio apps, which are available for free to download in the iTunes and Google Play stores. Also, Mondays, 12 p.m. Eastern, 9 a.m. Pacific time, we are streaming on the Nothing But Net channel of Dash Radio. Feel free to check it out, because we will be available there for the foreseeable future. We are now sponsored, this show and HoopBall, by Hawaiian Isles Kona Coffee Company. Go to HawaiianIsles.com or search Hawaiian Isles Kona Coffee on Amazon to pick up some of their fine product. On the program today, we pick up where we left off from Sunday. I had a thought on Harry Giles. I finished it. John did not get a chance to rebut. He does to start off the podcast today. Then we delve into some draft talk. The Kings have a few second-round draft picks. We weren't able to confirm how many on the pod, but it's three or four, something like that. John's got some ideas about how who he would like the Kings to target. We get into that, and we finish up by talking about a couple random news items on the day. The Kings start back up play post All-Star break tomorrow, and we will be breaking all of that down come the weekend. But for now, enjoy this episode of the HoopBall Sacramento Kings podcast. Back with us on the program via a cell phone because we are having technical difficulties. Sacramento Kings beat blogger for HoopBall, Mr. John Schifferle. How are you, sir?
Having a pretty good night. How are you?
I'm having a great night as well. We are on the eve of Kings basketball post the All-Star break. I don't know who they're playing because I like to live my life day by day. I'll find out tomorrow. Before we ended the podcast on Sunday, or as I should say, when we ended the podcast on Sunday, I did not let you rebut what I was saying regarding Harry Giles and what I view his inability to get where he needs to go on defense as fast as he needs to get there. What is that rebuttal that you were hoping to get in before the end of the show last Sunday?
Sure. The key thing to keep in mind with Giles, and it's talked about a little bit that he doesn't have that much experience, but if you really break down just the fact that he played his freshman year of high school and then missed his entire sophomore year with an ACL tear, played his junior year, and then missed his entire senior year with another ACL tear, and then only played, I believe, 300 minutes in total at Duke, he just hasn't played much basketball before this season. It's 2 years of high school and 300 minutes of college, which is almost like, you know, the resume of a D3 bench player. So he's not someone that's going to come in and instantly have it's pretty remarkable when you watch him how much of an awareness he already has, given that lack of experience actually playing meaningful, truly competitive games.
And I think the fact that he is being as aggressive as he is on offense is a good sign. What his strengths are, he is displaying. And those aspects of your game that maybe you don't get worked on each and every single day because it's impossible or really not a great idea to be scrimmaging every single day will come over time. But the main takeaway is they will take more time. Is that really the gist of what you're saying?
Yeah, and there are just certain ways you're not going to play defense in a high school basketball game. You're not going to play the same type of defense as you would in the NBA because the players just are not nearly good enough to like guarding the pick and roll is incredibly hard. There's no high school players out there that are challenging Harry Giles in the pick and roll. So where is he going to learn things like that? Well, he could have learned a little bit in AAU if he was really playing a ton, but again, he missed his whole senior year. He could have learned a little bit at Duke, but he only played 300 minutes. And then, you know, last season they played in practice, but they're not really going. It's not the same as playing in a game. So he just has so little true competitive game experience that it's reasonable to expect him to. There's the deficiencies that he has. It's not wild to think that he's really going to take off next year just with the knowledge that he's getting right now.
Couple that with the fact that last year he sat out, and then with this year got an opportunity to play right away with the injury, the calf injury to Costa Kufis. Then he sat for a bunch of games, and now he's back in the fold there. That inconsistency of minutes also probably causing some, or at least the reason why that part of his game is not where I would like it to be right now. And I think, of course, like I've said on this pod many a times, it will eventually get there with more reps. And now I completely forgot what we were going to go to next. Oh, yes, that's right. I just remembered. Thank goodness. I watched Duke Louisville last week. At the end of that game, that was quite the game to watch. They release the first or second iteration of their draft board. I just saw this morning via Bill Simmons' Twitter that the Ringer has released version 1.0 of their draft board. Everyone and their mom knows that the Sacramento Kings, as of now, do not have a draft pick, a first round draft pick for 2019, but I'm sure they have many multiples of second round draft picks. And this being a King-centric podcast, we want to break that down for you a little bit. And we have just the man to do it, John Schifferle, who is on top of each and every pick that the Kings could possibly make in that second round. Where would you like to start, sir?
I'll start with this. It's a really tough draft to rank almost throughout. I mean, there's going to be a player available to the Kings in the second round that no one expected. And people say that every year, but this year that seems like it's going to ring true more so than in the past. I think there's players, for anyone who watches a lot of West Coast basketball, Brandon Clark with Gonzaga, who personally, I would have him as a top 10 player. I would be not surprised if he went outside the top 10, but I don't think he should. And it's mostly because he has a very abnormal skill set. He's a little older, just a player that's a little hard to peg. And we'll see where he goes exactly. He's not going to be available for the Kings unless they move up. But he's an example of a player that, because there isn't really true standout talent like last year, it's going to be harder for teams to rank them. And I think there's going to be biases that come in terms of what types of players you like, what types of players you don't like. And for that reason, I think their second round picks are uniquely valuable. There's not a ton of talent necessarily in that second round, but I don't think it's much different than picking at, let's say, like the difference between 25 and 35 seems almost non-existent.
And it looks to me like the Kings have four selections in the second round. Is that what you are working under?
I think they have two.
I'm trying to search for it on my phone.
I think they traded their own. Yeah, where are you seeing four?
Well, I saw that they had three in August from a Sactown Royalty article that I just pulled up. But didn't they get one in the Alec Burks trade or no?
They did, and that may make it three.
Okay, so it's three or four. It's a. It's a. It's. We'll we'll live knowing that it's three or four. And from what I saw in that article, it looks like those picks are going to be mainly in the middle of the second round. Is there a player in particular you have your eye on that you think could fall that far? All of the chatter that I have heard so far about this draft is it's weak. I would assume that that would cascade down to the second round as well, or am I wrong?
Well, it's tough. I think the weakness to me is most apparent in that like 2 to 10 range, where Zion's obviously just in a complete class of his own. Last year, I don't think Kings fans are that bummed that they got Bagley instead of Ayton, right? There were fans that at the time maybe did want Ayton. I probably would have preferred Ayton at the time. Now, not so much. But either way, it wasn't like Ayton was going to be this transcendent guy and Bagley was like, oh, we'll see what happens. This year, Zion pretty clearly is a lock for one, and two is going to really pale in comparison to Zion. So I do think that the weakness really is at the top more so than, you know, the later first round and early second. But yeah, even there, it's just not that it's not that deep. But there are good role players in this draft. I think it's unique in the sense that you look at some weak drafts and you don't see a lot of players that ended up, like the Ben McLemore draft, very few players from that draft ended up actually having even just a role in the NBA 5-6 years later. I don't think that's going to be the problem here. I just don't think there's going to be much more. Like, Zion's going to be a star. I don't know how many other all-stars there would be after that, and that's kind of the weakness to me.
Okay, I'm looking at Real GM right now, and I'm seeing 1, 2, 3. I'm seeing 3. So we'll go with that, under that assumption. Give me somebody in particular that you've got your eye on. Kings are always, well, I shouldn't say always, but there is a player on the, or a position on this team that the Kings have found themselves looking for recently, have plugged that hole a little bit with Harrison Barnes and also Alec Burks. It's the switchable 3-4 guy that can play some defense, extend the offense with the 3-point ball, kind of the Draymond Green prototype, so to speak. Somebody like that that you see that the Kings might be able to target there in the second round?
Sure. So I think one that a lot of Kings fans have certainly talked about, at least on Twitter, is Admiral Schofield from Tennessee, who, if you look in mock drafts, he's a perfect example of what I was talking about earlier, where it's going to come a lot down to preference and just what you look for in prospects. But I've seen him go in the mid to late second round, which I think is a little ridiculous. And I've seen him go in the mid to late first round in different mock drafts. People seem to have him all over. And in my mind, he would be a steal with any of the Kings' second round picks. So it would be really nice to see them, you know, actually land a player like that. But I don't know that he's going to be there, but he does fit what you said. He's undersized even for a 3, strictly in terms of height, but he's very switchable defensively. He plays hard. He's absolutely massive. He's built like a tank and, you know, would just be a nice versatile player to have coming off the bench.
It seems like a guy that you would want to take a shot at. I mean, these second round picks, you're bringing them in, you're hoping for the best. The contracts are extremely favorable to the teams. Seems like a guy that would fit in, especially given what the makeup of the Sacramento Kings roster is right now. Strengths and weaknesses for the say his name one more time. Adolf, not Adolf.
Admiral Schofield.
Admiral Schofield, which is an A+ name. I want him just because of that.
So the benefits, I don't know how much this matters most of the time. For some reason this year, it does kind of strike me. He and Grant Williams are the two clearly the best players on a Tennessee team that's one of the best teams in the country. And they do it by just playing. They both have really good feels for the game, and they also both play really hard. And so it's just nice to see players like that succeeding. And I just think given his size and athletic ability, he'll be able to find a role in the NBA. I think ideally he ends up as almost like a PJ Tucker type, where I don't know how much he's going to do offensively necessarily. He won't really get in the way there, but he's not going to be like a plus for you there. He'll make the right plays. He'll make the right passes. He can shoot. The shot's a little questionable, but I think he'll be able to shoot enough in the NBA if he's a power forward, certainly. But the minuses are he maybe doesn't have the highest upside because he is 6'5" and absolutely needs to. I think best case scenario, he fits in as a power forward somewhere as like a stretch four. If he needs to play the three, I don't know that that's a huge deal, but I would like to have someone who's maybe a little more skilled on the perimeter as a small forward. So I think that's the problem, is that I see here he's listed 6'5", 240. So he's just huge. And we'll see. If he can't play the four, I have trouble seeing him as much more than like a ninth man in the NBA. But I'd be shocked if he can't play the four. So, but you are giving up some height there if you have him. So that's maybe the weakness.
How many discussions did we have about Amon Shumpert's height on this podcast? And now you're going to bring up somebody who's 6'5" and you want him to play the four. Granted, he is 240 pounds.
Yeah, I mean, size has a lot to do with that. And I think Admiral Schofield has a nice wingspan. I think Amon Shumpert does too. But the difference is, like, you look at PJ Tucker, you're giving up a lot in terms of height with him. I mean, he even plays small ball five for the Rockets at times. And I want to say he's 6'6". So if you're really physical and you have a nice base that you play with, sure, you're going to give up something in terms of height and probably even length, but you can easily make up for it. And it really does open up a lot for you. The problem with Shumpert was that he wasn't as physical as he needed to be, just because he did what he could, but he's just not that big of a guy. And then played a little too much like a point guard when he's not really that. And so that's just not a problem I see Schofield having.
You're bringing up somebody for the front line, a place where the Kings, despite the fact that they have a number of big men to fill those positions, they can always use another guy. Depth is always something you're going to want to try and get as much of in the NBA. Even with the loaded backcourt that the Kings have, you're going to also do the same for those positions as well. Is there somebody in the one and two, the point guard or shooting guard realm, that you see could be somebody that the Kings would want to bring in and take a look at?
As far as point guard and shooting guard, if someone falls, I could see like a Ty Jerome out of Virginia. I mean, I don't know that he would need to fall to the Kings. I think he would be most likely available when they pick. But he's kind of an interesting, you know, high basketball IQ guy that can shoot well. I believe he has incredibly short arms. I could be wrong on that, but I think that's always been a problem for him. But, yeah, just kind of a combo guard that could be nice off the bench. I don't think he has all that much upside, but he's interesting enough to me. And then Coby White out of North Carolina. I think he's been getting a lot of buzz as someone who's going to move up. But, you know, you look at players like last year, who did Minnesota pick really late?
Josh Okogie?
Not Josh Okogie, the other one out of Ohio State. Kata Bates Diop. So he, I wanted to say, I would have guessed he was going to go around 27. Minnesota got him in the 40s. So you never know. There's just going to be those guys. I would say Coby White's probably going to go around 15 to 20 when it's all said and done. But, you know, some guys fall. Happens. So he's a really interesting one. If he actually lasted to where the Kings are going to pick, I would absolutely jump on him. And then Kevin Porter Jr., I don't know if you followed him out of USC, but he has had some, I don't know if you'd call it character concerns, but just some, he's very raw. He's got some nice upside, but yeah, he was theoretically a lottery talent, hasn't really played much for a while now, and just got back into the rotation a couple weeks ago, I think, and maybe he'd last until the second round, they could pounce on him.
When you're picking that late, you might as well take a swing at things with Denver Nuggets taking a swing with Michael Porter Jr. at the 14th pick in last year's draft. So something like that could most certainly happen. There are a couple news. By the way, you know a bunch about the draft. Is there something that we're not covering draft-wise that you want to get in here? Because with this part of the season and the schedule, we don't have a game to go over, which means we have plenty of time to discuss as much draft stuff as you want. Is there something else that you would like to add that we have not gotten to?
Sure. I have a couple quick hits, if you will. Have you heard of Talon Horton Tucker?
No, that sounds like some sort of publicly traded company I should be aware of, but I'm not.
Yeah, it does. He's, he literally looks like PJ Tucker. I want to say he's 6'4". Probably really needs to get into better shape, but I find him really interesting. I see a lot of people that actually have him, like the Draft Express guys I know are really high on him. I want to say they have him in the late first right now. Some people don't even have him in the top 60. I really like him out of Iowa State. I do think he has a really large frame that he may need to keep to actually, I just don't know where he plays. He's got a lot of ball skills, is maybe too big for those ball skills, but is a interesting defender, can pass a little bit, can shoot it a little bit. Yeah, I would check him out if I were you. There's some interesting stuff there. Darius Bazley gets linked to the Kings in the second round sometimes. Combo forward that I don't know much about because he's not playing college basketball. So, yeah, I mean, interesting enough.
Where is he playing?
Combo forwards are, he doesn't. I think he's like an intern for New Balance or something.
Oh, that
guy. Might
be
mixing him up with someone else. Yeah, that guy.
Okay.
So I don't know anything about him because I can't really watch him play. But for that reason, maybe yeah, it's almost like Mitchell Robinson with the Knicks. He was thought to be a lottery talent before he went to college, then decided not to play at all. Well, I don't know if he decided, but didn't play at all in college, kind of left the campus and went to the Knicks at like 35 last year and is very raw. And we'll see if he works out. But I think if they could redo the draft, he would go higher now. So maybe that's Darius Bazley, but we'll see. I mean, that's the type of guy you take a swing on late, right?
Swings late are the definition of second round draft picks. Couple news items here since we are at this point in the season with the Kings starting backup play tomorrow. Corey Brewer signing a second 10-day contract with the Sacramento Kings. Your analysis, John Schifferle.
The Kings have never really used their 10-day contract as well. I don't understand why there's a limit on how many you can use, and you choose to use one on a player who plays a position you need, frankly, and then he doesn't play, and then you sign him to another one. Like, there are players out there that they could target that they may actually be interested in playing. I think it goes without saying, but just to be clear, Corey Brewer is not a long-term player for the Kings. At best, he gives them a nice stretch for three games, and then they send him packing. So I just don't understand the use of the 10-day contract. It's a small thing to quibble with because how often do 10-day contract players really turn into much? But, you know, Dallas found Yogi Ferrell on a 10-day contract, and Kings fans seem to like him quite a bit. So, you know, there's ways to find nice young players for basically nothing on 10-day deals, and they could actually turn into a nice bench option down the road. So don't really get why it's being used on Corey Brewer, but we'll see what he can bring if they actually choose to play him.
Corey Brewer has been everywhere. I don't ever remember him providing any sort of impact for a playoff team. He's on there. He's on the team for depth in case a few guys roll their ankles or something worse happens. He's a serviceable NBA player. I saw this on Twitter. He scored 51 points one time. So there is some game in there somewhere. And put into a scenario where the Kings need some scoring from him for whatever reason, there is a chance that we could see something close, semi-close to that magnitude.
He is maybe the most improbable 50-point game player of all time. So, I don't know. He doesn't really shoot that well or even well at all. He plays really hard defensively, and he's a pretty good athlete and can fill in at forward for the Kings. So, I think he's also, isn't he like 30 at this point?
I think he might be older than that.
He's not a long-term piece for them. And there's no, like, hidden, I don't even think there's a hidden, like, 10-point-per-game guy in there. He's just a nice person to put out there that just can play defense. It's almost like he was actually a pretty good fit on Philly for what they needed, just someone that had some positional versatility that cost very little that could play defense for them and at least try to be a shooter. I would have said the same thing about the Kings, but they seem pretty content with using the small forward minutes with Harrison Barnes. And so now that they have Barnes, I don't really see how he fits. Clearly, Dave Yeager doesn't yet see how he fits. So we'll see how it goes.
In other news, by the way, one day we're going to spend a few minutes discussing how we follow the Kings, the different devices and sites and methods that we have. One of mine is some Google alerts. I get a weekly digest of articles about the team. That was how I found out about them making, initially found out about them making the $30 million payment on the loan that is supposedly, I guess, now retired, because that was going to happen sometime in mid-January. This week, though, there is news. The Kings are going to be the first in the NBA to bring predictive gaming to the NBA. Today. You're about to find out, John.
Okay.
According to the press release, the Kings announced that they are partnering with Swish Analytics to demo the NBA's first dedicated space for a free-to-play in-arena predictive gaming experience called the Sacramento Kings Skyloft Predictive Gaming Lounge. What this means is folks who are sitting in the... Where do these people sit? They're sitting in suites and lofts and where else are these people sitting? That's mainly where they're sitting. Yeah, okay, here we go. Suite, loft, and balcony box ticket holders will be able to do this during the 4-game homestand from March 17th to March 23rd. They go to these iPads, they put down what they think certain stats will be by the end of the game. Those stats include player points, player assists, margin of victory, total, player turnovers, players to get a triple-double, and then they'll be notified of the outcomes via email at the end of each game. This seems like gambling. And John, my question to you is, does this add to your interest in going to a Kings game in order to do something like this?
Yeah, you know, anytime I go to a basketball game, I always think, wow, there's not enough things that aren't basketball to do here. And so I'm always looking for more ways to not watch the game, of course. And,
well, but this is the whole point of this is to get you to watch the game because you got some action on things. This is actually making you more interested in the game.
When you say it's free to play, does that mean there is an option to do it for free? Like if I don't know, if I'm like 10 and I obviously can't gamble, I walk up to it and I'm like, hey, I think I like De'Aaron Fox a lot. And so I'm going to say he's going to get a triple double. And then I put that down. Could I also be an adult and say, I think he's going to get a triple double. I'm putting $50 on it.
No, so you can't do that. Good catch there. I read it and I didn't realize that. So they play. You're playing for free, and you compete to win exclusive prizes. So it's really not that interesting, I guess. Yeah.
I just think if you're going, so Bill Simmons talks a lot about how he got into gambling because the Patriots were perpetually bad, and so it was his way of keeping interest in football other than just watching a team get pounded, you know, every Sunday. And as a Kings fan who watched them be bad for such a long time, I can kind of understand where you say, I know the Kings aren't going to make the playoffs this year, but it would, let's bet on the over under and just like the playoffs aren't the target anymore. It's them hitting 26 wins or whatever, right? And so I could see how that could definitely add to the experience if your team sucks. Even if your team's good, it could be fun to throw some money on it. But if you're at the game, you want to bet on the game, sure, whatever. But, like, I just don't think you need to find reasons to care about the game other than liking basketball. Otherwise, maybe you shouldn't be at a basketball game.
I'm okay with it. I like it. Anything that can get the fans more interested in the game, can get people more engaged with the game. Also, this is, of course, going to eventually lead to people being able to put bets on the game at the game. And when that eventually happens, when you can open up an app and put down a bet on the spread or the over-under, I will be destitute and homeless 6 to 8 weeks after that happens.
Yeah, I do. This is probably a logistics exercise for when they eventually roll out the gambling. And I think if we know anything about Vivek and the way he operates in business, he likes to get in front of things. So like when Bitcoin was first coming out, he was the first NBA team that was going to allow people to use Bitcoin to purchase things. And, you know, on down the line, we just see betting is the new thing. It's now legal in certain places. And so I think he's trying to get out in front. I think this is an exercise to find out how he can make that work. I think you're right there. And that's not such a bad thing. I just think, I don't know. It is what it is. I think, if anything, they have a problem right now with people not paying enough attention when they go to the games. We've talked about it on this podcast. Other people have talked about it. I think the last thing they need is one more thing to be distracting people from getting back to their seats before the third quarter starts. And if that's what people want, it's what they want. But, you know, if you're going to sell Sacramento as a free agent destination to people, and maybe this is overblowing it, but the thing that you could have pointed to, and maybe you can, we'll see what it's like if the Kings make the playoffs this year. The thing that you could have pointed to 15 years ago is look at what Arco Arena looks like when the Kings are playing. People are losing their minds. Like people love going to Arco Arena. It must be a lot of fun to play there, assuming the people like you, which means you're a Kings player. You know, that's a selling point that you can have that, I don't know. I just think every time you add a distraction to the arena, you're taking away from that. And I just, you know, I don't care that much, but I don't love it.
There's a clamoring for it. Otherwise, they wouldn't be doing it. We'll see how it pans out. And odds are that they're going to use this in such a way that it's going to add to the fan interest during a ball game as opposed to taking away from it. At least that is how I hope it would be approached. That's going to do it for us here today. There's a juicy topic that's been making the rounds because of the fact that a two-year anniversary came up and there was a pronouncement made by a rather prominent member of the Kings front office regarding something that would happen at this time and place in this particular year if something were to happen. And so far it hasn't happened because what he said would happen has so far happened. If you kept up with me in what I just said, join us on Sunday when we talk about it so I can more thoroughly explain it.
Yeah.
He's John Schifferle. You can find him on Twitter, at John Schifferle. You can find me on Twitter, at my buddy Chris. For all of HoopBall's Sacramento Kings coverage on Twitter, it's at HoopBallKings. And for all of your NBA news, NBA fantasy news, and Sacramento Kings coverage, period, it's hoop-ball.com, the new and improved hoop-ball.com, where you can get the season pass, which gets you the premium content that HoopBall puts out for fantasy basketball. And if you're a new user to DraftKings and deposit $10 there, get to the season pass for free. HoopBall is now sponsored by Hawaiian Isles Kona Coffee Company. Go to HawaiianIsles.com or search Hawaiian Isles Kona Coffee on Amazon and pick up some of that fine Kona coffee today. You can find their show on iTunes, Stitcher, YouTube, Google Play, as well as the iHeartRadio, HoopBall Radio, and the Nothing But Net channel of the Dash Radio app, 12 p.m. Eastern, 9 a.m. Pacific Time, Mondays. All three of those apps are available for free to download in the iTunes and Google Play stores. For John Schifferle, I'm Christian Villere. See you Sunday.
This has been a HoopBall presentation.